this evening with some beautiful spiritual music performed by Twyla, Stephen, and Paul. So just sit back, relax, enjoy the music, enjoy their talent, and let's start with giving them a warm welcome.
To me, to me when it's too dark to see you, when I am sure I have reached the end. Hold on to me when I forget I need you, when I let go. When I don't feel like I'm worth defending, when I'm tired of all my pretending, hold on to me. When I start to break in desperation, underneath the weight of expectation, hold on to me. Hold on to me. Hold on to me when it's too dark to see you, when I am sure I have reached the end. Hold on to me when I forget I need you, when I let go, hold me again. I could rest here in your arms forever, 'cause I know nobody loves me better. Hold on to me. Hold on to me.
I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you, and you are mine. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you, and you are mine. Seek the face of the Lord and long for him. He will bring you his light and his peace. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you, and you are mine. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you, and you are mine. Seek the face of the Lord and long for him. He will bring you his joy and his hope. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you, and you are mine. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you, and you are mine. Seek the face of the Lord and and long for him. He will bring you his care and his love. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you, and you are mine. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have called you, and you are mine. Presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. In the midst of his children, the Lord said he would be. It doesn't take very many. It can be just two or three, and I feel that same sweet spirit that I felt oft times before. Surely I can say I've been with the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. There's a holy hush around us as God's glory fills this place. I've touched the hem of his garment, and I can almost see his face. And my heart is overflowing with the fullness of his joy. I know without a doubt that I've been with the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Ooh. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine.
I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Can you hear me? Absolutely beautiful. That song. Nothing like crying right before you get up here. Thank you. Good evening. Welcome to the 8th Annual Night of Hope. My name is Joe Anisich. I'm a co-founder of the Purple Project. First, I'd like to thank Father Mark for welcoming us back to his parish this year. And second of all, I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. So this year marks the 11th year anniversary of the death of our daughter Alicia and granddaughter Ava Lucille. Tonight my wife will share her spiritual journey. She'll share how she was able to battle unbearable grief and begin the healing process. It's a journey of hope and forgiveness. Afterwards, Father Dennis will be sharing his gift of healing. We've known Father Dennis for about 12 years now. We met him just before the death of Alicia and Ava. So he's been on our grief journey since day one. And we're really fortunate and grateful to have him supporting us even today. And I'd thank him if he was here, but I don't think he's here yet. A few announcements before we begin. First of all, we have a few prayer boxes around. So we have one at the entrance here and the entrance here. And then also we have one over here, and we have relics of Saint Maria Goretti here, and Sherry's going to be talking about her a little bit in her presentation. But feel free to put any intentions in these prayer boxes. We have prayer warriors that pray over these intentions for a year straight, and we've gotten feedback of wonderful miracles that have happened where people have put prayers in these boxes. Second, Catholic Charities Counseling Department's here. We do have private rooms available if you'd like to see a counselor, and they have a table in the narthex. Also, the Sacrament of Reconciliation is going to be offered today, and we'll have a priest over in this corner and one over here as well, and there'll be ushers to guide you to the priest if you want to receive that sacrament. So we're going to begin Sherry's presentation with the song Rescue, written by Lauren Daigle, performed by Twyla, and accompanied on piano by Paul. So let's welcome Twyla and Paul.
You are not hidden. There's never been a moment you were forgotten. You are not hopeless. Though you have been broken, your innocence stolen. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send down an army to find you in the middle of the darkest night. Is true, I will rescue you. There is no distance that cannot be covered over and over. You're not defenseless. I'll be your shelter, I'll be your armor. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send down an army to find you in the middle of the darkest night. Is true, I will rescue you. I will never stop marching to reach you. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear you whisper you have nothing left. I will send down an army to find you. Stop
Good evening. Welcome to our Night of Hope. My name is Sherry Anisich, and it's an honor and a blessing to be here with you tonight. First, I would like to thank everyone who made this night possible. Thank you to Twyla and Stephen for their amazing voices. I like to do a half hour of worship so that the Holy Spirit gets moving in here, and I really feel it. Although that song is so sad, but thank you to Paul and the piano. They have done many, many nights of hope with me, so it's so nice to have them here with me. Thank you to Father Mark for opening up this beautiful church tonight again this year. This is our second year at the church. Thank you to Father Dennis. Father Dennis, like Joe said, my children went to Holy Family, and Father Dennis and I have been friends for many years, and he'll be here later to do the healings. And thank you to our Night of Hope committee. We could not do this without you. We have many, many people behind the scenes making this possible. And also thank you to Catholic Charities. This is the first year that Catholic Charities will be here if anybody needs assistance tonight or after. Tonight I'm going to be sharing a very tragic story about the death of my 21-year-old daughter, Alicia, who was 6.5 months pregnant when she was killed by her supervisor that she had known since she was 16. Although it's a tragic story, my hope tonight that you will see how, like Twyla just sang, that God sent an army to rescue me from the pits of darkness. But first, I'd like to share a little bit about my daughter, Alicia. Alicia was born August 28, 1990. I was going to be a single mother with Alicia, so it was a little scary. I was in labor with her for 17 and a half hours, and I remember the nurse handing me her and saying, "You have birthdays and graduations and prom and weddings and grandchildren." I remember just feeling so overwhelmed at a 20-year-old girl. And when the nurse left, I remember holding my daughter. We were alone, and our eyes connected, our souls met. And I knew all I had to do was take her home and love her. And that's exactly what I did. About a week later, I moved in with my parents, and about a week later, Alicia was crying a lot, and my mom said she was colicky, but my mother instincts kicked in, and I knew something else was wrong. I took her temperature, and it was 103, and the doctor told me to come in right away. When I got there, they believed that she had bacterial meningitis, so they were taking her to another hospital, and it was verified that it was bacterial meningitis, so they flew her in a helicopter to Chicago. And when we got there, they said that she had 1 foot in the grave and that she probably would not make it through the night. A little boy had come in with 104 fever. By now, Alicia's fever was up to 105. And that she probably would not make it. A little boy had died right before she came to the hospital. But Alicia made it through the night. And about a week later, some of the side effects of bacterial meningitis is blind and deafness. And they told me that she wasn't responding to light or sound, but I didn't care. I was just happy that I was gonna take my baby home. And then about 2 weeks later, she was ready to come home, and she was responding to the lights and the sounds, and hence she was called the miracle baby. Until the day she died, we always called her the miracle baby. Alicia loved Disney. Even before she passed away, when she was pregnant, she bought a video for her daughter, the latest Disney video. And she always had like the bedding and the curtains and the rug, you know, all the Disney stuff every year. She would always ask for all that. And I think her favorite character was Goofy, because she was Goofy. Alicia was a character. Alicia tried every sport. She did tennis, and she did soccer, ice skating, she did dance, she did volleyball, cheerleading, skiing. She loved horseback riding, but she stunk. She was not good at sports at all. I remember being at Holy Family, and we'd be biting our nails for her to make it over the net for volleyball. And I ran into one of Alicia's friends at the mall recently, and she said Alicia played doubles at Joliet Catholic Academy. And her friend goes, "I asked Alicia, why did you play tennis? You stink." And because they never made it up to the tournaments because Alicia was so bad. And she said, because there's no cuts. They don't cut you from the team. And my mom told me I had to play a sport or join a club. Alicia loved to laugh. She loved Dane Cook. And she loved the show Friends. And she liked to break things. Alicia would go on her walker, and then the walkers moved around on wheels. And she would just pick up something and throw it on the ground and break it. And even when she got older, we would have a holiday, and I would ask her to carry the bowl to the table, and she would drop it, and she'd always go, whoops. No matter if it was $5 or $500, she would always just go, whoops. And she just never took life serious. And I love that about her. Alicia liked to scream in the house. She would always yell my name, Mom, Mom, come here, like something was wrong, and I'd come running, and she'd go, I'm awesome. And then Brianna would, she had a sister and a brother, and she'd call them. They'd come running, and what? I'm awesome. Both of those sayings, whoops, and I'm awesome, are written on her headstone. Alicia attended Western Illinois University. She was studying to be a forensic psychologist. She loved CSI and Law and Order and all that stuff. Alicia had a lot of amazing friends. She never got into that girl drama and never talked about anybody. And even at Alicia's funeral, her friends came up to me and just told me what a great friend that Alicia was always to them. Alicia loved her family very much. I met my husband, Joe, when Alicia was 14 months old, and Joe asked me to marry him 7 years later because he said that he wanted to take his time because I had a child. I think it was a little too long, but, and when he asked me to marry him, he also gave Alicia a ring too. Alicia was so excited to start our family together. We moved here to Shorewood after we got married, and about a year later, I was pregnant, and Alicia cried and cried and cried the whole 9 months because she had been an only child for 10 years. And nobody was coming in to step on her thunder. But after my son was born, Alicia was the greatest big sister. She loved her brother so much. She went to all his baseball games and basketball games and volleyball games. And Luke had a learning disability. He was dyslexic. And Alicia would sit for hours and hours with him at the table. Unlike me, I was not patient, but she was. And then about 3 years later came her sister, Bree. I think she was a little jealous of Bree. She always said I spoiled her, but Brianna looked up to her big sister. Alicia would come home from school, and Brianna would grab her leg, and she'd drag her to her bedroom, and they would paint their nails, and they would watch Friends, and they would do things that big sisters do together. And they would just, she just loved her so much, and she was so excited that she was going to be an aunt. She just would always say, I'm going to be an aunt. Alicia has a big extended family who misses her very much. When Alicia told me that she was pregnant, I was shocked because Alicia had her whole life planned. She was going to go to college, and she was going to have a job, and she was going to get engaged and get married. And Alicia was going to be a single mother. The father, Alicia met the father of the baby in college, and at that time he was choosing not to be involved. But Alicia said, I can choose to be happy or I can choose to be sad, and I choose to be happy. She really embraced her pregnancy with such joy. She had that pregnancy glow about her. And she bought her own crib. She drank green drinks every day. She had magazines that she did. She went to bed early. She had a full-time job already. And to this day, I thank God every day that I got to see what type of mother that she was going to be. That all ended on August 19th of 2012. It was a typical Sunday for me and my family. Alicia was in Door County attending a wedding with her supervisor. It was his sister's wedding, and he had nobody to go with, and Alicia said she felt bad for him. And we all attended church, and they asked Luke to serve that day, and then they asked us to bring up the gifts, me and Joe and my daughter Bree. And Father Vitas was doing the mass that day, and Father Vitas, I don't know if any of you know him, he's an icon here in this area. And I'll never forget when we went up there, he said, oh, the whole family's here. The whole family was there, even though Alicia wasn't there. We did not know that she had passed away. After church, we went out to eat, and then we stopped at my brother's house, and then we came home, and my daughter went outside to play, and she came running in the house, and she said, "Mr. Jones is here," and he was a police officer. He was our friend that we knew from Holy Family. Our children went to school together, and sometimes he would stop by and just say hi, so I never thought anything of it. And I started coming down the stairs to greet him, and he was standing at the bottom of the stairs, and he had tears in his eyes. I knew then, that Alicia was gone, but I thought she had died in a car accident. And I did not want to go down those stairs because I knew if I went down the stairs that my life would change forever. And I just remember him having a chair pulled out, and he kept just saying, come down here, sit down, sit down, sit down. And I remember just knowing I couldn't go down. I don't know how long it took me, but I finally made it down, and he said, "There's been a homicide." I can't even begin to tell you the utter despair, the shock. I was literally in the pits of hell. I found out that he had 4.5 hours of confessions, and I found out that he woke my daughter up in the middle of the night. He beat her, he strangled her, and then after he killed her, instead of calling 911 to save the baby's life, he raped my daughter. I'm sorry to be sharing this gory details with you, but I feel it's important because I'm here standing and sharing my story with you, that God gave me this strength. He said that he had planned it for 2.5 hours because he wanted to have a relationship with Alicia, and she did not want to have a relationship with him, and he did not want to go home single. For many, many months, probably years, I laid in bed. I laid on a couch, and I remember I had this Blessed Mother picture next to my bed that my aunt gives to everybody. And I remember every night I would look at it and I would say, "Please, God, please take me, please take me." And I know I have other children, but when you lose a child, it's unbearable pain. And I remember waking up and saying, "Oh," and I wasn't suicidal, but I just didn't want to live anymore. Shortly after going up to the selection, there's so much going on when you have to. Me and my husband went up to Door County for everything, motion hearings, jury selections. When we first went up to Door County, we found out that he was using something called voluntary intoxication for his defense, which pretty much means you can commit murder if you're drunk. Even though he said he planned it for 2.5 hours, he actually was tying ropes and stuff to tie her up. And so we were pretty shocked that this defense was there. It's not here in Illinois. And unfortunately, the first trial ended in a hung jury. Two women jurors found him not guilty. So now my husband and I were going to have to start all over with, from day one, from all the motion hearings to the jury selection. And this was a very high profile case there in Door County. So it was very, very difficult to have to relive this again. After the first trial, we knew that God had another plan for our family. I remember hearing the hung jury, and me and my husband just left. And we got in the car, and we both said that we need to do something. We need to change this law. And so the next day, we got together with our friends and family, and we all wrote letters and to the legislation in Door County to change this law. It would not go for my daughter's case, but we never wanted anybody else to have to sit through this again. So we got a call from a legislator, Noss, and he had tried to change this law for 7 years unsuccessfully. So we worked with him, going to the Senate, speaking with the Senate. Actually, the sister of the person who killed my daughter went with us to change this law. And successfully, we were able to change the law with a unanimous yeses. There was no noes. So that was amazing that God worked that. And Scott Walker signed into law the Alicia and Ava Law Initiative on April 16th of 2014. The second trial ended in a conviction. That picture is my daughter Brianna at the time. Now she's in 20 years old, studying abroad in Italy right now. And that was the only thing I allowed my children to go to, was the sentencing. They were very fearful. They slept with us. And I wanted them to know that he would never, ever get out of prison again. And there, part of my army that God sent me, is Father Carl from Door County. My girlfriend had called there a bunch of churches before going up to Door County the first time. Father Dennis was having a mass said here for our family, and she wanted somebody to say a mass there for our family. And Father Carl said that he would do that. So we met Father Carl the first day going up there. And he went to both trials. He used to go to our hotel. He used to sit with us. And he's just an amazing man that we still have a relationship with him. He's helped us a lot with our Purple Project. We talked to him on Skype. And that's the balloon release for Alicia and Ava. Our friends and family came with us to the sentencing to celebrate that. This man will never, ever be able to harm anybody again. And the reason why I'm here, how am I able to stand here before you? It started with the Blessed Mother. And like I said, God's army. And it's the army that he sent here on the earthly side, and then the army on the heavenly side. The first thing that happened was at my daughter's funeral. And if anybody lost a child, or if you lost somebody significant, you don't really know you're at a funeral. I knew that was my daughter in the casket, but my brain kept saying, don't worry. She's just in college. You're gonna be okay. I remember sitting in the front pew and they were singing the Ave Maria in memory of my granddaughter, Ava. And I remember everyone looking at me and you could see my tears, but I remember feeling kind of mad, like you could look at me all you want, but you'll never feel what I feel inside. These tears don't mean anything. And it was at that time that the Blessed Mother spoke to me and said, it's me, the Blessed Mother. I understand your pain. My son was murdered. Now I know the story of Jesus and the crucifixion, but I wasn't thinking about anything at all but that I will never see my daughter or know my granddaughter. I would never know if she would have Alicia's personality. I would never know if she'd like Santa. I would never know if she had Alicia's big brown eyes. And about a second later, I felt coldness around my feet. And the Blessed Mother spoke to me again and said, it's me, the Blessed Mother. I have your daughter and granddaughter with me. I'm washing your feet for the sacrifice you, your daughter, and granddaughter made before coming into this world. I'm not trying to be rude, like I said, but I didn't want the Blessed Mother to have my daughter or granddaughter. I wanted to have them. And I did not share with anybody that this happened because for a long, long time, because I thought, oh, they're gonna think I'm crazy, they're gonna put me in a loony bin, I'm grieving. And I only shared it with my husband. But then I started thinking about Alicia sharing with me a year prior that we were packing up her car to go back to college. We took a break in the garage and she said, Mom, I'm gonna die young and I'm gonna die a horrible death. And I said, why would you ever say that? Don't ever say that, my goodness. And she never did say that again. But to this day, I thank God because I feel like that was her saying goodbye to me. It was a blessing that I had that day. That was her preparing me for her death. Her friends also, she told her friends that she was gonna die like a CSI episode and that a Lifetime movie was gonna be made of her. And she already had picked out her funeral songs. And then I told you we knew Father Dennis before Alicia died. And after Alicia died, Father Dennis told my husband that he was told that our family would be through a tragedy soon. And it really makes me think that there's nothing we can do to prevent our death. And I just want to read this Bible quote that I found last year. It's Psalms 139:16. It says, "Every person's days are preordained by God, even before birth." God knew that Alicia was coming home that day. After the Blessed Mother spoke to me, I wanted to learn everything I could about her. And I had that 5-hour drive to Door County, so I read a lot of books. And in there, they talk about the rosary being a weapon against evil. And we definitely were dealing with evil. So during the second trial, the Blessed Mother spoke to me again and said that she wanted me to do the rosary during deliberation and that I will know that she was present among us the whole time. So after the deliberation, we went to lunch and then we all did the rosary. And after we did the rosary, about 5 minutes later, the advocate came in and said, "There's a verdict." And I remember running to the jury room or to the courtroom. And I remember sitting there, I was the first one there, and I remember just being so scared that maybe he would get away with it and that maybe there would be another hung jury. I sat down and I looked at the clock and I realized that it took 2.5 hours for the jury to come to the verdict. And I remembered that it took Cooper, who we called him, 2.5 hours planning my daughter's murder. And then I realized it was 3 in the afternoon. And then I realized also that he had killed my daughter at 3 at night. I knew in that moment that the Blessed Mother was around, that she was showing me that everything was going to be okay. And he was convicted. The last thing I want to share is my friend Stacy was having a Renew conference, and it was the first one she was having, and she knew my story, and she asked me if I would speak at it. And I didn't want to speak at it because, one, I'm afraid to speak. When I was in my master's program, I avoided every speech I could by making up fibs, and I did not want to do it. I also had children who were younger, and I did not want them to think that they're, you know, people saying, "Your mom's crazy, she's talking to the Blessed Mother." So I didn't know if I wanted to do it. And probably 3 or 4 weeks later, I knew it was time that I needed to tell her if I was going to be doing this or not. And I said, "God, if you want me to do this, you need to give me a big, huge sign, big, big." And at that time, I worked at Silver Cross Hospital, and I go in the employee entrance, and they have like a key fob or whatever to open up the door. And I was going up onto the second floor, and I've worked there for 6 years, and there's nothing there. Like, you can't put anything on there, it's just a little square thing. And I see something leaning on it, and I'm like, "What is that?" And I could see, it's the Blessed Mother. And one, I said, I was just like so taken back, like, "Oh my." And then I was like, "Oh, I'm gonna have to do this now." And I just wanna read to you the message that is on the back of this car. This is the Blessed Mother from Medjugorje. And on the back of the card, it said, "If you knew how much I loved you, you'd cry for joy. Dear children, without you, God's plan cannot be realized. I knew that the Blessed Mother wanted me to share some of the things that she had spoken to me. She said, tell everyone, no matter what religion they are, that I am their mother. I am the mother of the nations. I am the mother of hope. The only thing that's real is love. It was also placed in my heart that I would have a retreat center, and I was to purchase a Blessed Mother statue and call her Our Lady of Hope. Miracles would happen there before my death and after my death. Now I would like to bring up my dear friend, Stephen, to sing the Ave Maria. This wants you to close your eyes, and I want you to imagine Mother Mary here tonight, wrapping her arms around you, our Mother of Hope.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Maria, gratia plena, Maria, gratia plena, Ave, Ave Dominus, Dominus tecum. Benedicta tu in murielibus, et benedictus, et benedictus fructus ventris, ventris tui, Jesus. Ave Maria. Ave Maria. Mater Dei. Ora pro nobis peccatoribus, ora, ora pro nobis, ora, ora pro nobis peccatoribus. Nunc et in hora mortis, in hora mortis nostre, in hora mortis, mortis nostre, in hora mortis nostre. Ave Maria.
Thank you, Stephen. That was beautiful. I hope you felt Mary. She's here tonight. She's here to bring you to Jesus for healing. I always forget that one, Stephen, sorry. The next thing that happened on my journey was I used to run a cabin in Frankfurt. It's called the Porta Nautical Center. And I used to bring my picture of Alicia and my rosary and my picture of Ava and the Blessed Mother. I needed to be alone. This was about a year after Alicia died, maybe 2 years. And I just wanted to be by myself. Everybody was moving on with their lives, and I was stuck in despair and grief. And I just loved it there. There's 50 acres, and I would walk around, and it's just so beautiful. And one day I was walking, and this woman, there was a little path, and I said, "What is that?" And she said, "It's a labyrinth." And I said, "Oh, what do you do?" And she says, "You can do a mantra, or you can say a prayer, or you can ask God a question, and when you get to the middle, you'll get your answer." And there was a lot of people there at the time, so I knew I had some questions that I wanted to ask God. So I went back to my cabin, and I came back later. Nobody was around. It takes about 20 minutes to walk in. And I walked in, and I just kept repeating, "How do I heal? How do I heal? how do I heal? How do I heal? For 20 minutes. When I got to the middle, I heard loud and clear, be grateful. I'll tell you, I was not happy with that answer. I was very, very angry at God. I fell to my knees. Thank goodness no one was there because I was screaming. And I said, you want me to be grateful? My daughter was murdered. And then I get another answer. I said, well, an innocent child was murdered. A little baby. You want me to be grateful? Still no different answer. So about 5 minutes later, I got up and I stomped out of there like a little child. And I started walking back. You want me to be grateful? And I started saying everything I was grateful for. I was grateful that my daughter had 21 years. She could have died like that little boy in the hospital that had the 104 fever. I was grateful that I had a mother who taught me about God. My mother at 52 years old found out she had terminal cancer, dying at 59. And not once did she feel sorry for herself. She always said, God is merciful and it's His will, Sherry. I was grateful that I had a grandfather who lived with me. It was my mom's father. That was his only child, and he lived with me at the time that she passed away. And I got to see a man grieve the loss of his child with such grace. Every day he did the rosary. Every day he did the Divine Mercy Chaplet. He painted like toy boxes for the auction at Holy Family. He's probably 100 at this time. He lived 101. And he taught me to live again. Never did I think I would be losing my daughter 6 years later. I was so grateful for the many friends and family that I had come to my home and sit with me while I cried and cried and cried. And all the meals that were made, I think I had meals for a year, and all the people who watched my kids, and just amazing friendships that I developed through the loss of my daughter. I was so happy that I had other children. I met other grieving moms on this journey that this is their only child. I was happy that I could possibly have grandchildren. By the time I got out of there, I fell to my knees again, and I thanked God because that day is the first day that I was able to see light in that darkness. I was able to see hope. The next thing I want to talk about is forgiveness. And I want to tell you that this did not happen overnight. This was many, 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 many years of it. And it started with my son, Luke. Luke was attending Joliet Catholic Academy at the time. He was a freshman, and I was picking him up at school. And I was sad that day because it was Ava's birthday, and he asked me why I was sad, and I told him. And he said, you know you need to forgive him. And I said, who, Cooper? And he's like, yeah, the religion teacher said we need to forgive him. And I said, well, did your religion teacher lose somebody to murder? And, you know, I just attacked my son. And I go, did you forgive him? And he's like, yeah. And I, you know, probably yelled at him, how could you forgive him? And I just really thought after that, if my son, who loved his sister so much, I mean, he missed 74 days of school after Alicia was killed, that I really, really need to pray about forgiveness. And I told God, you have a huge job to do if you want me to forgive this man who killed my daughter. The next thing on the journey was St. Maria Goretti. And if many of you don't know who St. Maria Goretti is, because I did not at the time, she is a 11-year-old girl who was stabbed 14 times by her neighbor who tried to make sexual advances to her, and she refused them. Ironically, but not ironically, St. Maria Goretti's relics are here tonight. So we also have them over here. And her relics were coming to St. Mary's. And my aunt and many other people, you know, were sending me emails and texts. You should really go to this. You should really go to this. And I kind of was getting mad thinking, I'm not going to forgive by going to some relics. And so I decided that I would go. And I waited in line for about 2.5 hours. And they had her in a casket, and the relics inside this casket. And you could bring your religious items up there. and I had brought a rosary, and I had brought my necklace, and I put it up there. And when I sat down, I had the rosary in my hand. And I felt this little vibration, a little tickle. And I asked my aunt, do you feel this? And she said, yes. I don't know if she did or not, but maybe she was just saying that. But and I knew then that that little mustard seed was growing, that St. Maria Goretti was a part of that army that God was sending to heal me. The last thing is the Eucharist. My girlfriend had sent me a video. My friends all knew that I loved to hear about miracles, and she had sent me a video about a host, and I think it's Buenos Aires, that the host had turned to flesh. And what happened is somebody dropped it on the ground, and obviously it's the body of Christ, and you cannot throw it in the garbage, so they put it in water and they water plants with it, or they throw it down a holy sink. And when they did that, it started developing this, you know, bloody flesh. And 2 years later, a forensic pathologist, they gave it to forensic pathologist, and they didn't tell him what it was. And after their findings were that a murder had occurred, that a man had been beaten, and that the heart was still beating when they did their forensics. And I just thought, wow. And I started looking up more, and there was more miracles of the host. And every year on Alicia's birthday, I always have a mass said for her. So I was going to mass that day, and I remember going up to receive the Eucharist. And I sat back down, and I started crying, and I said, Alicia, I'm sorry. I'm not offering this to you today. I'm offering this to Cooper. He needs healing. He had no forgiveness at all. He had no remorse. And I said, his heart needs to heal. His heart needs to change. And I thought about that miracle video, and I'm like, we need a miracle here. So later on that evening, I was going to my friend. She was having a women's retreat. Usually on Alicia's birthday, her friends would come over and do Patron shots. Alicia liked Patron, I guess. And I was drinking way too much. I definitely went to alcohol through my pain, and I realized that it wasn't serving me anymore. I knew that if I kept on this journey, that I would not heal, that I would stay on the day that Alicia died. So I decided to go to my friend's retreat. So I didn't know anybody there, and she asked us to sit in a circle, and she asked us to pray. So we were sitting in silence and praying. And when that happened, Jesus put his hands over my prayer hands, and they were the biggest hands I've ever seen. I can still see the crevice in his hands. And he said, I'm so proud of you for what you did this morning. And I remember opening my eyes up because I thought, I'm so close to Mary, why is he here? It's a women's retreat, and I closed my eyes, and I was thinking, what did I do this morning? And he showed me taking the host and praying for Cooper. He said, I'm so proud of you for what you did this morning. I love Brian as much as I love you. Now, he was calling him Brian by his birth name. I've known Cooper for 6 years. That was his name that we knew him by, but he was calling him Brian. He said, I love Brian as much as I love you. And then he showed me the love that he had for Brian. And I'll tell you, it is a love that there is not on earth. I had no judgment towards one person that ever hurt me. I felt pure peace, pure love. You know, I always prayed that God would show me what my daughter felt, because you're not a mother one day and then your child's gone the next day. You want to know that they're okay. And it was through praying for Brian that I got to feel the peace and love that my daughter feels in heaven. And Jesus said, all you have to do is pray for him, that prayer is forgiveness. you're praying for somebody, you can't have anger in their heart, and that Jesus would take care of the rest. I'd like to read, I know you probably can't, oh, you can see it, a letter that I found on the internet last year, and I kind of changed it a little bit because I feel like it's so profound. It says, I have forgiven Brian for my sake and for my daughter Alicia, so I felt it was important to let go of him. I could no longer hold on to the anger. It was affecting my entire life. I choose to stay in the divine love of God, the source of forgiveness and mercy. A prayer for Brian Cooper, and I ask you all to pray for him. I pray for him because, like me, God knew him before he knitted him in his mother's womb. I pray for him because, like me, he was created in the image and likeness of God. I pray for him because Jesus agonized over his soul just as he did mine in the Garden of Gethsemane. I pray for him because it's only through prayer and grace and mercy that his heart will ever even have the remote chance of repenting and turning to Jesus with contrition. It's difficult during these times like these to remember that God loves all people, the killers as well as the victims. We know that Alicia and Ava Lucille are resting in the arms of their loving Savior. This is why I pray for the one who committed these horrendous acts. His is a soul in danger of being lost. His is the one who has wandered, the one that Jesus goes after, the one he came to save. Many who recite the rosary often add the St. Michael prayer between decades, a prayer given by the archangels to the children of Fatima. O my Jesus, forgive us our sins and save us from the fires of hell. Lead all souls to heaven, especially those that are in most need of thy mercy. It seems to me that someone who could take the innocent lives of two innocent and precious souls would be someone in most need of Christ's mercy. I will not excuse his actions. I will not blame a system, a parent, a condition, or a society. I will not exchange hate for hate and revenge for senseless killing. I will follow the beautiful example of Jesus Christ and choose love and forgiveness. Instead, I will pray for him. So after I was able to forgive Brian, and my heart started to feel love instead of hate, I was able to form the Purple Project. But I would not have been able to do that without God's army. There's Father Carl, I already talked about him in Door County. I already talked to you about Father Dennis. Not a coincidence that I was at Father Dennis's church at my daughter's passing. That's Sister Faustina there. She actually is known as Lisa Duffy in the community. She is 2 years older than my daughter was at Joliet Catholic. And at the time that my daughter died, she was becoming a nun. It's like a 7-year process. I don't find that a coincidence either that God had her as my neighbor. She would come over on my darkest days. My daughter's car was being taken one day and I was sad and she was there. She also brought me statues of St. Maria Goretti. She talked to me a lot about God's mercy and forgiveness. To this day, her and her little nun friends come to my house and spend the night. There's Father Vitas. He was a huge part of my healing. And there's an A in the sky. You know, I love how God gives us signs when we're in a lot of pain. I believe in signs. And the one with the light shining down, I had a dream. That's my daughter's sentencing. We are in the shade there. I had a dream the night before, and she said, take a picture, Mom. I'm going to be in the picture. I didn't know what she meant, but I did it. And that is a light shining down on a picture of a shirt that she wore that had Alicia's picture on it, an Ava's picture. And that is her best friend that it's shining on, Olivia, who spoke on behalf of Alicia's friends at the sentencing. A little bit more of God's army. The women there are only half of the women. I have a lot of friends here tonight that aren't in this picture, but this is the most that I had. This is my Bible group. I knew that I needed to hear God's word, and I joined a Bible group with moms from Joliet Catholic Academy. You know, you always think your army's going to be, you know, your friends and family, but sometimes it's not. That little snowman is a little 5-year-old boy gave that to me, and it was the first time that I went in to do a bottle drive, and I'll share that a little bit later. And I went into the kindergarten classroom, I think this was very soon after Alicia, And I started asking for change for bottles to help moms, and I started crying. And this little boy came up to me with tears in his eyes and gave me that little snowman. I still have that snowman, and I brought that snowman with me to the second trial. And I just opened up my purse and I would see, and it would bring me so much happiness and joy. And I thought of that little boy. The Starbucks tea, you never know how you're going to change somebody's life. Before Alicia died, I was going to school to be a naturopathic doctor. I had been in school for 2.5 years, and I had just met this friend 2 years prior. And she came to my house every day. And if I didn't want to talk to her, she would just leave that Starbucks tea, and I knew that she was there. And I had so many. It represents all the friends and family who sat with me for hours and hours. And to this day, I still don't get a Starbucks tea if I'm in a bad place. I always get little signs on license plates. The first one says joy, and that was like 3 years after we used to cut down a Christmas tree, and I didn't feel like doing it for many years. And first time I did it, I seen that when we were pulling off to get our tree, and I knew that was God saying, joy, enjoy it. And joy is a heavenly word. And the heaven too is right around Christmas. I was crying and saying, Alicia, where are you? And honestly, when I looked up, it said heaven too, and her and Ava are there. And the Abba and All God, I got that on the same day. Somebody asked me to go Relevant Radio to learn about mercy because I didn't know about it. And those both were on that day. And Abba means, you know, more of a personal relationship, daddy. And All God, I knew God had me. I knew God had never left me. I want to talk a minute about suffering. I'm almost done, too. You know, God placed it in my heart shortly after Alicia died that this would be my greatest blessing. And he also told my husband that this would be his greatest gift. Now, we never shared that with each other until years later. And I realized that it is my greatest blessing. Do I miss my daughter every day? I miss her every day. We were very, very close. But I never would learn love and forgiveness. I would never learn all the things that I came here to learn. And when you unite your sufferings with Jesus' sufferings, he can change everything. Miracles can happen. He can change that pain into a purpose. And that's exactly what happened and how the Purple Project was formed. We launched the Purple Project in 2014 with Pay It Forward cards, and it says Alicia's saying on there, I can choose to be happy or I can choose to be sad. And, you know, every year I still hand out the Purple Project cards on her death date and her birthday, and I'll buy somebody a Starbucks tea, or I'll, you know, give a $5 gift card somewhere or buy someone's groceries in line. The Purple Project has two missions. One, in memory of my granddaughter Ava, we help pregnant moms for the first year of their baby's life. This year we are sponsoring 6 mothers. I have a shop in my basement, and they come and get all the supplies they need. We give them financial assistance. We talk to them about God. We talk to them about, you know, making baby food. They have a job by the 1 year, or they're in school by the 1 year. And you know, another thing, part of God's army are these moms. Even though I didn't get to be a grandmother to Ava, I get to be a surrogate grandmother to all these beautiful babies that I get to hold. The second thing is we do grief retreats for grieving parents. I realized on my journey there was nothing around this area. I knew I needed to get away, and the only retreats they had were for alcohol and drugs. And I wanted to find some place to go in silence, some place to have counseling and help. And that's exactly what we do for our retreat. It's very intense. We have one-on-one counseling. We have group counseling. We do different therapy techniques to help with grief. We do art. We kayak. We go on the water. And we have them do stuff on the water in silence. And I'll tell you, I met the most amazing, amazing women and men, but we call ourselves sister moms because it's a club nobody wants to be a part of, but it's so good to be around other people who understand what you're going through. In 2018, we opened up the Alicia and Ava House of Hope. It's on 4.5 acres. This is where we have our shop in the basement. When the Blessed Mother said, you're gonna have a retreat, God graced us with the money for this retreat. In July 7th of 2020, we have a 12-foot Blessed Mother statue on our property that Father Carl from Door County came down to bless. Now I would like to share just a short video of the Purple Project.
Never end, trying to make it on faith in a struggle against the wind. I've seen the dark and the broken places, oh, but I know in my soul no matter how bad it gets, I'll be alright. There's hope in front of me, there's a the storm you finally find, where the hurt and the tears and the pain don't fall behind. You open up your eyes and up ahead there's a big sun shining. Right then and there you realize you'll be alright. There's hope in front of me, there's a
I just want to share one more thing with you. It's Romans 8:28, and Alicia's birthday was August 28th. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. No matter what you're going through, whether it's a sickness, a death of somebody, that God has a purpose for your life. And I'll be keeping each and every one of you in my prayers. Thank you so much for letting me share my journey with you, my army with you. Now I'm gonna call up my dear friend Kim. She's gonna tell you what's gonna happen for the rest of the night. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sherry. Can you hear me? Okay. Thank you, Sherry. Your kindness and strength are an inspiration to so many people. Your story, even though I've heard it so many times, is just an amazing, amazing journey. So thank you for being vulnerable and being willing to share that. As you all know, this night is very special to Sherry and Joe and the Purple Project. They're thrilled to be able to give back to the community that so generously supported them with meals, love, and many, many prayers when they were going through their grief. By now you know that this mission, the Purple Project, is Sherry and Joe's calling, a way for them to honor Alicia and Ava. They've hosted numerous grief retreats and are providing phenomenal support that is affordable to grieving parents, something that they realized was lacking during their journey. Purple Project has also assisted 31 single mothers since our inception, in addition to the annual Nights of Hope that have been attended by over 2,100 people. I'm sharing all of this because we as a nonprofit organization exist and are able to provide these services through the generous donations and support from those of you in the community. So if you feel it in your heart to donate any amount and support this mission of love and hope, there's an envelope inside the program booklet, and there's a donation box over here on the table. You can also donate online at thepurpleproject.org, or you can always mail something in. Once again, we thank you for your generosity. Soon I'll have the pleasure of introducing Father Dennis to you, but prior to that, I just want to go through a couple reminders. We have prayer boxes. There's one on either side of the church here and also one behind me by St. Maria Goretti's relics. We will have Catholic Charities available, their counseling department available in the narthex if anyone is interested or wanting to talk to someone. And we will have confessions available on both sides of the church after Father Dennis is finished. So without further ado, I will let Father Dennis come up and he will let you know what the process for the healings are gonna be. Father Dennis received this wonderful gift back in 1993 when he was a deacon, and he will be sharing God's healing with those of you who will need it tonight. So Father Dennis, you can tell them how this is gonna work.
You think I know? Good evening, everyone. And let me just get... Can you hear me okay? It's so good to see so many of you here tonight. And Sherry, once again, thank you for sharing your story, your testimony. I've heard it so many times, and it always just blows me away what you were able to do with God's grace and responding to that grace. So one more time, just thank you. One thing that's common to all of us is we all need healing. And sometimes when we talk about healing, we think of the physical, I would love it if someone deaf got to hear, or someone was in a wheelchair, jumped up, or someone had, has cancer and gets healed. That's great and wonderful when those things happen. But sometimes the biggest hurts we have are the ones that nobody sees. The emotional hurts, the betrayals, the broken relationships in our lives. Sherry shared her own, her own trials of learning to forgive and to let go. And sometimes there's the spiritual. We're angry with God because we feel God abandoned us at some time in our life, or we feel the church has let us down. So healing covers a wide variety. It's not just physical. Tonight, my approach is really simple and it's pretty straightforward. Well, first off, healing can happen in a variety of ways. First off, as was mentioned, the sacrament of reconciliation is going to be available. That is a sacrament of healing. Some will say, well, I don't need to tell a priest, I can tell God. Well, when you're talking to the priest, you're talking to Jesus Christ. And the words you hear from him are coming from Christ. And sometimes there's a freeing and a power of just saying, this is where I am broken, this is where I need healing, this is what I've done wrong, and to receive God's mercy and forgiveness is incredibly powerful in healing. So if you're feeling that tug, like, gosh, I haven't gone in a while, or Sherry's talk has stirred some stuff up, please take advantage of the priests who are making that sacrament available. It's an amazingly powerful sacrament. As mentioned, we also have counselors. If you feel you need to talk to someone and just vent, that's great. We have St. Maria Goretti's relics here. Ask her to intercede. Not only part of her story was she was able to forgive her murderer, and her murderer converted and repented. Forgiveness is very powerful. So ask St. Maria Goretti to intercede for you. My approach to this is very, very straightforward. I don't make a big show out of it. We'll just have you come forward, we'll have you line up, and I just come up and I just pray silently over you. I don't ask you what you want prayer for a couple of reasons. Number one, there's 300 of you and there's one of me. And if you even take 10 seconds to talk to me, that's 3,000 seconds, which is an extra hour, okay? So just come forward and trust that God will give you what you need for healing tonight. And all I am is just simply a vessel. I'm just here for Christ. It's not about me. And I just pray over you silently for as long as I feel the Lord's telling me to, and then I move on. As I'm praying over you, you might feel really peaceful. That's great. You might feel a warm sensation at some part of your body. That's great. You might feel the need to cry. That's great. Some people get a little, they're really sensitive to God's actions. They kind of, it looks like they're fainting and falling on the floor. It's not a big deal. It's called resting in the Spirit. We'll have people behind to catch and just lay you out. Doesn't mean that God loves them anymore. Doesn't mean that they're being healed anymore. It's just the way some people are, and we go with it. Okay. Like I said, it does happen. So I just want you to be aware of it. If it happens, why I'm not reacting that somebody just fainted in front of me is because I'm used to it. But tonight, also, I'd like you to do maybe just for like 10 seconds, take 10, 15 seconds, turn to the person on your left and then turn to the person on your right and ask them what you would like to be healed of tonight. Tell them what you're looking to be healed of. Well, we can do that right now. So just turn to the person on your left, to the person on your right, tell them what you want to be healed for tonight. Just take about 10, 15 seconds. Okay, the reason why I had you do that is now that you have something to pray for. Because so often we come to these things, we get focused on this is what I want, this is what I want, this is what I want. Like I said, we're all in need of healing. So now as you're waiting to come up to be prayed with, spend that time, we'll have the rosary being prayed. Spend that time praying for the person that I'm praying for. Spend that time praying for the person on your left and on your right. This only works if we're in a spirit of prayer. All right, so And I can tell when you're praying, it's a lot easier for me to do it. When you're not praying, it's like pushing a rock up a mountain. So we need to be in a spirit of prayer in order for God to work it and have this happen. I think that's about it. Okay. Okay. All right, two very important things. Number one, we will be praying the rosary. If you didn't bring your rosary with you, shame on you. No. If you need a rosary, just raise your hand and we will have rosaries distributed to you, okay? And then secondly, and we're going to go on the honor system here, okay? If you are fairly ill, and being here for a long period of time is going to be a distress to you, please let those folks come forward, and we will pray with them first so they can go home, and because we don't want this to be a burden to them. So if you really are in a, you know, in a spirit of distress and really need to get out of here soon, like I said, we're going to do the honor system here. We're in a church, so let them come forward. And then finally, last thing I need to remind you all, we are in a church and we do have the Blessed Sacrament here. Jesus himself is here. Jesus, who is the healer. Jesus, who gave sight to the blind man. Jesus, who raised Jairus' daughter. Jesus, who healed the woman with a hemorrhage. Jesus, who was a friend to the poor and to the sinners, is present to us in the Blessed Sacrament. So, and so just sitting here and being in prayer before the Blessed Sacrament is incredibly, incredibly healing. So I just underscore that just so that we are aware that, you know, Jesus is here, and Jesus is here to heal us and to set us free.
Just give us a few minutes to clear the equipment out. We're going to be saying the rosary during the healings, and we're going to have ushers that will usher you up. So just all stay seated for the moment. Thank you.